Good morning. Good morning, good morning, good morning. I hate to break up a good conversation or 20 of them, but thank you. Want to be respectful of your time. And we have a lot of chances during the day for you all to connect and have some conversations. So we'll just hit pause on all of those. And we can continue throughout the day. If anybody doesn't know where they're supposed to sit or has a question, the amazing Gina can help you out. So don't be shy asking her questions. She has a fantastic team today to help us all learn and grow and be in community. So just a quick welcome. Thank you for taking time out of your day. I know that this is a busy time of the year. I think this is like the fifth required all-day event this week. So I know some folks aren't with us just on account of that. But thank you for carving out that time today. We had an agenda shared with all of you, so I won't go into the details. But I wanted to just do a bit of recognition right off the bat. We wouldn't be here if it wasn't for Chris. If you could stand up, Chris. I was in a faculty community of practice exit end session for the summer, and I actually got goosebumps because I was thinking about, I've only been here 5 years. So our Office of Institutional Effectiveness is 5 years old. First, when I came here, Chris's vision and drive to do things better and faster and at depth for our community is absolutely fantastic. And we dreamt up this workforce integration network. Want to give a shout out to Crystal Rawls. Dr. Crystal Rawls, she had an emergency, was not able to be here today, but it was with her vision that all of this has come to be, building off of evidence-based research and practice. So just so exciting that in a short 3 years, we would build up this dream. We have had support from the leadership on campus and be able to get a grant to make it all happen. If that wasn't enough, what we want to do today is talk about, this is a launch, right? So it was kind of a soft launch in the summer. So you'll be hearing in a minute from a couple faculty and what they had done and what they achieved and what they plan to do next. But really, we're launching for the fall semester. So we will hope you have a fantastic time today and invite you back in March to hear about, all the great things that happened this semester. But we are also planning for another grant, a much bigger grant, that we will apply for in the spring. So there will be some conversation and some workshopping. So we're kind of, a foot in both pools right now. So we can't do this without the participation of community. So to really make it feel like we understand who the community is, Chris, you can stand back up as our champion and key lead. And if you are a administrator who heard this idea, whatever your initial thoughts were, now is in support. If you are an associate dean or a dean, a faculty or a chair, please stand up. I know there's at least two. There we go. And if you were somebody who we came to and we said we want to do this project, but we don't really understand something like how to write really good position descriptions or how to engage with the community, please stand up. If you are somebody who was a faculty person and has been involved in this or interested in this or implemented something around this, please stand up. If you are a community partner who we couldn't do this without, either who came here because you already have a firm place or you're learning about your place or you've supported interns, please stand up. If you are a student intern, a fantastic intern, please stand up. Yes. If you are somebody else who I've forgotten to mention because I'm a little sleep deprived, but very excited that you're here, thank you for being here. I know that our IT group has been incredibly supportive given a lot of advice, encouragement, and sometimes a shoulder to cry on. So thank you for that. And also to the amazing media and tech team. We thought it was really important to capture what's going on here today and extend beyond some of the reporting of just the numbers of people and capture the actual stories of what's going on. So I'm over time. I will stop there. But I just want to underscore two quick points. You can sit down. Thank you all. Thank you. Thank you for everything that you've done for us so far. And one is that this project, I think, is really unique. Really, really unique. I know that you're not supposed to say those two things together. Because the opportunity to look at workforce development at CSUDH is not necessarily unique. We're known as have a rating of number two in economic mobility in the nation. That's not a surprise. We work really hard at that. But this aspect of getting money to do that, that's different. So this is, we're going to be talking about our Connecting Minority Communities seed grant. And this is something that is a first of its type to be provided to Hispanic-serving, minority-serving, and tribal communities. And so this is something where billions of dollars has been dedicated from the government in a way that has never been done before. So together, I am excited to continue the conversation of how we can make the best use of those funds and the next funds to make sure to meet the needs of all the different, you know, pockets and groups in our community. I'm very excited to introduce, we had thought Dr. Parheim would be here himself today. Unfortunately, when your boss, the chancellor, tells you you have to come to a meeting, you have to go. So he instead provided us with this video that we can enjoy now.
Hello, I'm Dr. Thomas Parheim, your president at California State University, Dominguez Hills. Welcome to the fall kickoff of our Closing the Digital Divide program. You know, unfortunately, I'm unable to attend today's conference in person, but I wanted to provide a video greeting to all those here today, because the cause of closing the digital divide is one that is near and dear to me. It also reflects the spirit of educational equity and social mobility that is at the heart of everything we do here at California State University, Dominguez Hills. Now, I'd like to start off by thanking all of you for coming together for this auspicious occasion. We've brought together faculty and staff, administrators, students, community partners, and advisory board members here today to take a comprehensive look at where we are in this process, as well as where we're headed. Now, I also would like to acknowledge the key role that our own CSUDH Workforce Integration Network, under the direction of Crystal Rawls, has played in developing and rolling out this vital program. Now, as we all know, access to technology and digital literacy are increasingly vital components of success in the workplace and in everyday life endeavors. The CSUDH WIN program will help address the digital divide in local communities and seek to dissipate the equity gap by providing students with essential equipment and training that would otherwise be unavailable to them. It will also give our own CSUDH Toro students invaluable experience, and I'm talking invaluable, working with our partnering organizations, making this initiative a win-win for the campus and the local community. How good is that? You know, the legacy that the people in this room are building will positively impact the South Bay and California as a whole and reverberate through generations of computer science teachers and learners. Integrating computer science education into the curriculum of K-12 schools in deserving communities is an important step in closing the digital divide that leaves many would-be scholars on the outside looking in. And we can't do that. Our local partnerships are an essential element of this program, as they enable us to develop and earn public trust in our efforts. And these partnerships take on many forms, but all point in the same direction, increasing access and knowledge for our community. Now, we work in partnership with the support of both external and internal campus partners to develop and co-create strategies. Let me say that again. We develop and co-create the strategies, as well as the protocols and the best practices we use throughout the program. And so, by hosting community-led conversations with those who are most impacted by the digital divide, in learning about the evolving barriers and needs within each community, we're able to develop strategies uniquely tailored to their specific goals. That's what's so exciting about this program. So we endeavor to learn from those individuals and entities that are impacted the most by inequitable access and provide opportunities for feedback. We provide community leaders and members with updates on progress implementing the digital equity plan. And as digital equity plans are maintained and adjusted, we will continuously consult community leaders and members for feedback on the progress and proposed strategic shifts. We also work with our partners to co-develop clear goals and strategies with local communities to craft a comprehensive digital equity plan. And we recognize the unique expertise and experience of each member and organization involved in this partnership, a combination that strengthens the impact of everything we do. Now, the most meaningful partnerships are grounded in trust, where participating members and organizations value and respect one another. And I feel that trust acutely when I meet with partners and community leaders about this issue. So in tandem with our partners, we also seek to raise public awareness and provide ongoing support for low or no-cost broadband programs. And these can be an essential lifeline to those who otherwise would not have access to the multitude of resources on the internet. Now, in partnership with community-based organizations, your CSUDH engages in outreach throughout both analog and digital communications methods, in accessible formats, and in multiple languages to share available programs. Our community gets their information from a wide variety of sources, and we plan to be right there wherever that might be. So I'm excited, as you can hear, to see the continued growth and success of this program. The meeting today will enable us to build together, identify how to overcome barriers, and build a more integrated approach and framing model for our work to advance digital equity, a basic need of our community. With the support of the people in this room, your California State University Dominguez Hills will help smash the digital divide and create technology-savvy, academically engaged leaders throughout Southern California. So once again, I thank you for joining us today, and I wish you, right, have a wonderful conference and enjoy the day. And thank you for all partnering with us. Take care.
The leader we have at the university, you can only speak that way as a leader if you are profoundly affected and informed by experiences at your own institution. We know about this depth of divide because we experienced it like many other institutions through COVID internally, so that we can express that need externally and empathize externally with the community to say, how can we bridge this divide in very tactical and real ways? This is why part and parcel that we developed WIN as part of that community engagement. And it's not because we believe that we are going to be the best at doing something as a community group or an effort inside the institution, but it's because together in partnership, we believe we'll build a synergy that's going to be able to be an example throughout the nation to say, look at what we're doing here in the basin. Look at what we're doing in the South Bay. Look at how we're addressing those needs and moving forward. So it's hard to follow that act, but that's the reality. All right. So it is my pleasure today to introduce our plenary speaker. And although she doesn't need an introduction because most people in this room know who she was, I'm going to give her one anyway. Okay. So Sonia Backus-Hooks is the Assistant Director of Technology Services at LA County Office of Education, the nation's largest regional educational agency serving 80 school districts and approximately 2 million students in preschool and school-age children. She is a seasoned executive with over 35 years' experience in project management. In her 20-plus years at LACOE, Sonia has advocated for instructional technology, connectivity, professional development, and online education. Her district and school and site engagement expertise has helped secure state, federal, and corporate funding for student programs and teacher training across the country. Reporting to the Chief Technology Officer, Sonia provides a critical role in operations, compliance, and fiscal management for over $70 million annually. Expenditures include cybersecurity, data management, hardware, software acquisitions, and business operations and instruction. So without any further ado, I'm going to go ahead and introduce, because I've seen her slides. They're amazing. I can't wait to see them myself. Sonia Backus-Hooks.
Thank you, Chris. I appreciate that introduction. You know, like he said, Dr. Parham is, you know, he's a bad brother. I just love hearing him speak. So he resonated so well with me and all that he envisions for CSUDH. So you should be very proud to have a leader like Dr. Parham. So I do want to thank CSUDH for inviting me to come. Crystal is the one that invited me, and we're at a loss with her, but we just appreciate her diligence in working with us. So I am just going to jump right in. I've got 20 minutes, so I think they're going to give me some cues over here because I can be a little long-winded sometimes. I'm a preacher's daughter, PK. So I do enjoy having great conversations. So our conversation today is about closing the digital divide and community building. So what I want to do is just kind of give you a current landscape of what we're doing in LA County in technology and embrace some of the new things that we would like to do, and including our entire village in partnership of what we can accomplish together in this digital space. So the things that I'm going to be going over are, what are some of the barriers to achieve this community of partnerships and deleting this divide? What are some of the biases, the opportunities, and some action items that we're already endeavoring in, and some action items that we can look to create with each other. So feel free, if you have a question while I'm talking, raise your hand if you want to shout out. You know, I think Alan is like always poised to say something because he already said that I'm at table. So if you have something, feel free. I'm open to that, okay? This is a conversation. I don't want it to be a lecture. So let me start a little bit about who I am. He gave you an indication of who I am, but I am a Toro through and through. Okay? Proud of it. So I didn't know that I still had it in my drawer, but I did. So that is my college ID from when I started in 1986. So you can see that was like a typewriter probably, and then they folded it over and cut and paste the picture on. So I came to CSUDH out of St. Bernard High School, a private high school, and came here through the EOP program. So if you equal opportunity program, does that still exist here at EOP? So, you know, I liked my parents, so I didn't mind driving back and forth to come to a CSU. We lived in Inglewood, straight down the 110 freeway to come to Cal State Dominguez. So I was so thrilled and loved getting my bachelor's degree in business administration. I moved to the county office in 1997, and I got married in 97. I left, I got a new job in 1997, and I bought a house in 97. Three things you're not supposed to do. So that's what led me to come to the county office of education. And I love tech. We didn't have tech in when I was at Cal State Dominguez. So when I registered for classes, it was punch cards. You all kind of remember that? And you go pull your punch card from the gymnasium and you take it over to the mainframe and they tell you what your coursework is. So that was my level of technology in the 80s. And you know how much tuition was then? How much? Don't tell us. Don't tell us? Okay. Now, I'm going to tell you. My tuition per semester started at $289 a semester. $289, okay? So that was the 80s. And then when I finally graduated, I think I got up to maybe $400 a semester for all the units. But the technology wasn't there. But it was on the edge of starting, you know, to incorporate technology. So that's when I came back to the university, because I came to LA County Office of Education in the Technology Services Department. And at first I wanted to, you know, to come back and get my MBA, because I was in the Reardon program at UCLA and wanted to do that. But the job situation that I had working at Magic Johnson Foundation didn't allow me to come back and go to those classes. So I came back to Dominguez and got my master's in education technology. My thesis is in technology initiatives and their impact in schools. So I've been 20 plus years or more in this space trying to close the digital divide. When in the world are we going to close it? And how can we get there? And we can get there together. So one thing I did notice is when I was looking at the website for Cal State Dominguez, that I don't think my master's degree program is offered anymore. Is it offered anymore in master's in education technology or computer-based? I didn't see it. So that's something to think about, thinking it outside of the box, because our educators need to get that indoctrinated knowledge in computer-based education and technology. So, you know, I like to, like I said, get a landscape of the room. So there's this thing called digital immigrants, and those of us that were born before 1990. So if you're not afraid to raise your hand, if you're born before 1990, you know, we're digital immigrants. So we were not born with cell phones. You know, we had the dial-up phones. We, you know, there was, I call this BFG, before Google, right? So, you know, there was no Google for any of us. So digital natives, many of you that were born after 1990, you raise your hands, or digital natives, you know, age 12 and 2023. So digital natives, you were born with technology. You had a cell phone, right? You had all of those things, that internet. So there's a disconnect with some of that, and we've got to bring each other together, because, you know, we had to adopt the technology. You were born with it. So there's a lot of learning curves for us as digital immigrants where it comes to you all quickly. So we've got to be able to break down those barriers, just even communication. You know, sometimes I'll get a text from my colleagues and I have to Google it because I don't know what these little three letters mean, you know. So understanding that, you know, you all have to work together. We have to come towards you and you all have to come towards us, which those digital immigrants and natives. So just taking a look at some of the landscape of technology and what are the primary uses. Text messages, YouTube, Google, like I said, creating viral videos, TikTok, and the newest and greatest thing, our ChatGPT and our AI, and understanding how we can utilize that in education is critical. So when we talk about the delete the divide, you know, everyone who is in the younger age group that had that access to technology, everyone doesn't have that access to technology because of a barrier, socioeconomic barriers. And we found out in the pandemic how vast those barriers were just to have internet access, basic internet access. So these are some of the barriers. Who remembers, you know, those are in my age group, redlining? What was redlining back in the day? Can you tell me, Alan? Right. So they were specifically redlining areas where they were not going to provide loans and insurance to those areas, and they're predominantly black and brown areas. So redlining really actually still exists in the digital divide, because in my neighborhoods in South LA, Western, Manchester, we don't have high fiber networks coming through there because they said it's not a good profit vehicle for the AT&Ts and Comcast of the world. Or they're charging me $80 for internet access in South LA, and in Beverly Hills they're charging them $25. We've got data that backs that up. How can we continue to break down these barriers where there are institutional barriers and there are biases in some of here, and there's their haves and the have-nots? So let me just tell you some of the real data that we found in our partnerships with the county. So there are over 400,000 people that have no internet access. And we know if you have internet access in your home, you're utilizing Wi-Fi all the time. And just like electricity and running water, internet access is a basic necessity. And everyone needs to have it. Everyone has to have it. So they don't have the computers in their homes, and many of our residents in LA County have a lower socioeconomic income. So what are some of the other barriers that are there? Limited STEM programs and advanced coursework, because some of our teachers don't have that educational background in computer science. So how are we supporting our teachers to make sure that they can give those instructions to their students in K-12? Lack of support and advocates in school or home. If you don't know what you're missing, you don't know that you're lacking it. You know what I mean? It's like if it's not introduced to you or exposed to you, you don't realize that those opportunities are vast and that they exist. And many students, especially of color, never really developed those skills or perception that they can succeed in STEM. And we have to be advocates for the students that don't have that realization at home or in their classrooms. So what are some of the other biases? Students of color often encounter stereotypes. You know, you're supposed to just be on the basketball team or the football team. You cannot be studying science and technology. I have a really good friend who is about 6'4", African-American, and he went to Princeton, and everyone always asked him, oh, you got here on a football scholarship. No, he never played football a day in his life. He was a psychology major, and he did all his work in the classroom, and there are those biases because of the way he looks. Stereotypes are discouraged interest in some of those fields. And, you know, there's the self-confidence and knowing that you can achieve in those fields. So helping our students build those pride. And then there are some intentional biases with teachers and expectations. My husband is a high school counselor. And, you know, he's had to have conversations with teachers to make sure that they outreach to all demographics, women, girls, boys, into making sure that they get into those AP courses and make room for them in those AP courses. So we have to deal with those biases. So I do my own, you know, research also, and there's a black female student who just happened to be my daughter. And she said, and she went to California Academy of Math and Science, which is right here on the campus. I have twin daughters, so you'll hear a little bit more about them. But she said, STEM courses are competitive, and students are embarrassed to ask for help. I never even thought about that. You know, you just kind of sit in your own space and try to figure it out. And if you're struggling or your teacher sees that you're getting C's and D's on the test, is that teacher actually coming to the student and saying, how can I help you? Because oftentimes the student is embarrassed to ask for that help. I never even thought of that. And just because a student doesn't like math or isn't strong in STEM doesn't mean they can't succeed in it. They can succeed in it. We just have to give them the tools. You know, B's and C's get degrees. I'm just saying, right? Y'all remember that. You know, they're not going to look at all your coursework. Just go ahead and graduate and improve yourself in those spaces. So when I say B's and C's did degrees, my undergraduate degree, I think I graduated with a 3.2 GPA, and it was in business. So the college president at that time, he said, there are some of you that graduated cum laude, some of the summa cum laude, and others that graduated thank you laude, right? Okay, so I thank the good Lord that I graduated with my degree in business. So these are some of the opportunities in STEM. So these are career pathways that start all the way in K-12. So some of the things that can be established are coding and droning and cybersecurity and introducing students to the college career path at an early age. My brother is a Trojan, fight on, you know, wonderful. Yeah, you got the fight ons over there. But he took my daughters to USC at a young age and walked them around campus and introduced them. Every child does not have that opportunity, but we've got to make those opportunities. We got to bring those K-12 kids to college campuses and get them to understand the value of a degree in STEM and the opportunities that it provides to improve your livelihood. So there's a quote here that I pulled, and this career path stems came from Woz.com. So who knows who Steve Wozniak is? Microsoft? Apple. Oh, you said the wrong one. Yeah, Apple. So he said, a career in science and technology is not linear. It's about exploration and discovery. So we've got to give those opportunities for our students to explore. And these are a bunch of opportunities that are built from his Woz Ed, and it addresses K-12 and leads into careers in STEM. So another opportunity is ISTE. Are you all familiar with the International Society of Technology and Education? Okay, it's really kind of K-12 based, but you know it can move across all those curricular. But they have standards that are designed for K-12 for students. It brings information to educators, leadership, and coaching. So all the resources are already there. We just need to use them and make sure that we know about them, because there's so many hidden gems out there as far as opportunities in deleting the digital divide. Another opportunity here, and you know, I'm a woman, a black woman, so if you hadn't noticed. So I wanna always support girls in STEM and women in STEM. So this is a great website that does ways to be allies for girls and women in STEM. Picture books where it starts in younger ages and dismissing some of those stereotypes that we have in the STEM space. So I just want to kind of give you a portrait of what we're doing. You know, I like technology and I love animation. So, you know, I had to bring the Incredibles. So what are we doing in LA County to break down those barriers? Well, just to give you a portrait of how big LA County is, we are bigger than 40 states as far as our population and all the billions of dollars that we have here in the county. What is unique about LA County is that we also have rural communities, which is up here in the Antelope Valley area. That's still LA County. We go east to Claremont and Pomona, south all the way down here, and to the west, Manhattan Beach, Malibu, Las Virgenes. That's all LA County. So we're huge. And there are so many resources and opportunities here that we can all pull together and work. So just a portrait of who we are as LA County Office of Education and the K-12 space that we work in. We're 80 school districts. And like I said, our biggest school district, everybody always knows, LA Unified. But there's 79 other school districts. You know, Long Beach, Wiseburn, we deal with foster care. Gorman is one of our smallest school districts with students of only 74. So that superintendent is the principal, the cafeteria worker, the bus driver. Literally, she's doing everything. So we've got the teachers, we do charter schools, we work with our homeless population, foster youth, and our adjudicated youth. They're at promise. So students that had challenges that are in the incarcerated system, we still educate those students. So that's what we do. But what happened with the pandemic, which was the, you know, I won't say the best thing out of it, but one of the positive things that happened out of the pandemic is that we came together. So there's the Los Angeles County Office of Education, and then there's the county, the big county that our county board of supervisors are in charge of. So they brought us together and made sure that our students had access to the internet because they needed to be able to continue to have instruction. So they gave us $17 million, and I was huffing out hotspots to as many school districts who needed it. But they realized that that was just a Band-Aid. We needed broadband access in the homes of all of our citizens of LA County. So they initiated the Delete the Divide motion to continue this work past the Band-Aid of the pandemic. So this is what they've done so far. They've got checkouts of laptops in libraries, and they've got digital navigators in our county libraries that are doing work. They're working with career paths. My partner in the county is Selwyn Hollins. We call Sonia Hooks, SH, Selwyn Hollins, SH, you know, just kind of rolled together. So we work a lot in this space to make sure people know about the opportunities here in LA County with the free public Wi-Fi. And when I talk to you about the biases with the internet service providers and the connectivity, the county of Los Angeles is going to stand up its own internet access that's going to be free or low cost to all of the citizens in LA County. So they're doing a some pilot programs where they've done some of the trenching and are gonna get ready for the BEAD funding that's coming down the line from our president and very shortly. So the other things that we're doing is in partnership with the Affordable Connectivity Program, where we, you know, while we're working to build the network, we still wanna get people connected ahead of time. So right now the federal government has $30 discount for internet access. And it's interesting that when they created the Affordable Connectivity Program, you have to apply online for the internet access. I mean, come on, like, you know. So we're doing our best. We have an 800 number. We're out there in the community. We're hitting school programs and libraries and getting people to understand our Head Start program, getting people to understand the value of being connected and with a laptop. You know, everyone thinks they have the connectivity with just the cell phone, and they do, but you know, we know how much more can be done in having that connectivity with the laptop. So these are some other things that are available to teachers. Teaching and learning those digital skills for students. These are all things that can be done online. And we advocate for some standing up some of those skills personally. We also have some certifications that we share about teachers getting micro-credentials in PBS and multimedia. So those are some of the action items we have. And then cybersecurity is huge. And K-12 is one of the folks that are targeted by our cyber criminals. And we've got some activity going on right now as we speak. So those jobs are available now. Getting those certifications now. So that's something we can continue to promote, and getting those certifications even while you're in school. You can get those, you know, we do advocate for getting your bachelor's degree, but we also know that you can get a certification and get a high paying job right out of high school. So I'm just saying, you know. So we should be promoting some of that. Yes, I totally believe in the higher education and getting a degree and you move yourself up into management. But if we promote the certification programs, it'll help people afford to come to college. And they need to still be able to work and survive while they're getting their bachelor's and master's degrees. So another champion of it is putting things out on the internet. I just kind of put this out here. This, you know, the education buzz and access. So really being an evangelist of what is happening and what needs to be done in the Delete the Divide space. And calling out these, internet service providers. It's like, okay, now that there's a federal subsidy, now you want to come into the neighborhood. Well, you should have been here before. So how much more can you do for our community that you should have been doing in the first place? I'm just saying. So those are some of the things that I say in the Delete the Divide broadcast here. And then this is what I want to promote as far as your action items for CSUDH. Now, put no silos here. No, we don't create silos, you know, just to create silos. Everyone's busy. It's not intentional. But you need to look and see who's in the room and who's not in the room. And who else can be a part of this conversation? So I looked at your teacher ed programs. If we don't get the technology into our teacher ed programs and them learning how to share it with their students, we're doing a disservice to Delete the Divide. Our esports programs, there's so many kids that are out there doing the gaming. We need to understand that they can be creators of the technology and not just consumers. And then K-12 outreach, we're here. This is my team here, Chris and Johan and Alex. They're all from the County Office of Education. And I got tons of more people in the K-12 space that would love to be here with you all to continue those conversations and how we have that synergy together. And then workforce development, that's what brought us here together, WIN. So it could be done. So once you all at Cal State Dominguez, you know, pull all your entities together, then you wrap it around with all the rest of us, corporate partners. I put faith-based partners in here. Churches are a huge access in the community where you're getting to a trusted institutions. City and county officials and community-based organizations. Everyone has to work together, just like Dr. Parham was saying. You know, we can't do this in isolation. So we can have those meaningful discussions about it and how we leverage existing grants where we're not doing duplication of services and that we meld our activities together. So this is, you know, just a cool little book, and they spelled my name correctly, so I had to put it up here. So bringing the entire village together is required. We can't, you know, just stay in our own areas. We've got to, you know, all come together and work to delete this divide. And I'll give you a quick example of it. So I'm all about family and village. I live in Dominguez Hills Village, which is right across the street. And my husband is a K-12 counselor in LAUSD. I'm at the County Office of Education. My brother Chris is at Santa Monica College, and my sister Valerie is a robotics teacher in LAUSD. So our just own family of a village. We work at Southside Church of Christ. I told you I'm a minister's daughter, and we also have our nonprofit. So during the pandemic, when we saw that digital divide, our nonprofit was able to leverage corporate partnerships, and we were purchasing computers and giving them to not just students, but families, people that were going back to school, anyone that get their certifications. We were buying those and giving them out. When there was the need to get testing for and the vaccination, we brought those resources to our community. Because online, when they were trying to get the reservations for it, for the vaccination, our community did not have those online accesses. So when I went to the form, my community was not at the form getting those vaccinations. It was everybody else who had internet access. So we brought those resources to our community and made sure that because they had that barrier there with internet access, we helped to break down that barrier. So what's exciting about my village and my family is that we're all Toros. We're excited about it. So even though my husband went to Berkeley, he got his certifications here at Dominguez. I'm a two-time one. My brother was SC and then got his counseling credential here. And my sister is a three-timer. She got her master's, her credential, and another master's here at Cal State Dominguez. So we are Toros. And we are committed to being a part of this village because we're already here. So what are your action items here at CSUDH? What can you do to build your village? And what can we do to be a part of it? Sharing some of our action items of what we're doing. So I didn't pay attention to my time. I hope I'm okay with my time because I told you I'm long-winded. But connect with me on LinkedIn. I'm like 60 less days from retirement, so I can walk across the street and help you all with anything that you all need to do, okay? My kids have graduated college. They're down at San Diego now, and I got just a little bit more free time on my hands. So thank you for listening to my presentation, and I hope that it has engaged you to think and be realistic about what you want to do in deleting the digital divide. God bless.
Thank you.
we will go ahead and share everything with you today, all of the PowerPoints, the recordings, all the information from all the workshops. Let's go ahead and have some time for some Q&A.
Yes.
Quick question regarding the, Okay. Quick question regarding certification. Do we offer any of those classes here or courses here?
Good question.
Just so that they don't have to go through, getting their associates or bachelors in case that's not an area they need to go into.
Can someone in CSU answer that? Do we offer those certifications, the Google certifications in cybersecurity or any of those trainings? I know, you have to get certified by different entities, but I'm not sure. I can't answer that question. I think you do some things through extended education, but...
Yeah, there's several certifications for extended ed. Every student also has access to LinkedIn Learning, which is a nice kind of entry into decide if you want to get a certificate. And then through the Workforce Integration Network, we're building modules so that different faculty, you'll hear from faculty in a couple of minutes, have taken information for students about data analysis or project management or social media marketing to give you kind of a taste of it, and then you can see where you might want to go for those different certificates. But there are lots of options in extended ed. Yeah. Good question.
Okay. Any other questions? All right. Well, thank you for your time. I think we're handing the microphone back over to Alana.
So I think that thank you, Sonia, that was fantastic. And we are now going to have the pleasure of hearing from some of our faculty. So bear with me a second. We're going a little out of order, so I'll make you dizzy for just a second. So we are going to first hear real quick from Dr. Coleman. Has some things to share with us. And we have a couple other faculty, and then we will get to lunch in just a few minutes.
I just have the one, I think. Okay, that's it. Thank you. First, I want to thank you for the opportunity to actually wear a tie. And I wish Dr. Parham was here because he and these other two gentlemen and I would make four people out of about 100 that actually wore ties. I don't know about you, but mine has been sitting in the closet for about 3 years, and I figured this would be an event to wear a tie to. So thank you for that opportunity, and I'll take it off as soon as I'm done speaking. I joined the WIND program, I think on May 28th. So my question to you is, do you want to hear how I started into the program on May 28th and why, or do you want to hear about it as of today? How many wanted to hear about it as of May? How many want to hear about it as of now? Yeah, I was going to start now anyway. I just thought, I always like to take a poll. I've had more than 30 years of very successful business experience. And this program, and I started teaching here in marketing about 5 years ago. And unquestionably, the program has made me a much better teacher. It has made me a much better teacher in how I now understand an additional element that students need, and that's how to get out into that workforce with skills that are necessary. Our community project is with the Boys and Girls Club of Wilmington. It was started last year in the WIND program, and they did an incredible job. There was no program for young kids, meaning 7, 8, 9 years old, in soccer. In fact, there's almost no sports programs organized in Wilmington. Last year's group contributed so much that on September 8th, there were 230 kids that signed up, all kinds of assistant coaches. Nike contributed for every kid, their uniforms, their shoes, the soccer balls, the coaches, and they brought SC down, the landscaping department, and they completely revamped a field right across the street, an old unused field, so that the kids could play soccer. It's a going program. My role is now to help them with the second year. And how do we do that and get my students, our students, more digitally acquainted? So the first thing I did was, as they understood the program, I gave them 23 uses of social media. And they had to learn how to use Excel. Only two of them in the class knew how to use Excel. It's a digital piece of equipment. And they had to take all 23 and list specifics about why they would work or didn't work, what timing would be, whether there would cost, and so on. So we had two classes, mid-level marketing classes, actually put together this information. And now we've taken it, and we are using it to help build the program for next semester, which will include paid internships. So it's a real-world use. And I used to think that I could take my business experience and make my marketing classes real-world related. And it helped. I mean, I find a lot of the textbook a waste of time. I'm sorry for those of you that stick with textbooks. But I use it as the base and then talk about real-world experiences. This has added a dimension, which is why I can honestly say I think my teaching is better because I have a better understanding of what students need beyond just the core education. Now, one of the things that disturbs me comes out of a second project that we did, and he says 2 minutes, it'll be 2.5, okay? David Ochi, who is the director of our innovation incubator here, and my publisher, who is Made for Success, which is based up in Seattle, they do business books exclusively, they own all of the audio rights for all of the marketing and sales gurus in this country. They've got Robbins, they've got McKay, Ziegler, all of these greats. And we're taking and building apps from their speeches on sales, on management, and marketing. And we took the first developed app, and my class had to listen to all three of the modules, the first three, and critiqued it. And from that, we've now taken their critiques, and we're going to build a better app. But as part of that, I ran a focus group with the two classes. And we found out something really interesting. In asking them questions about their background, one of the questions was, what is your digital experience? I wanted to know specifically. What do you think they answered? TV? Facebook? Instagram? TikTok? X, or whatever it used to be called, Twitter? Only one person put Excel, and they had just gone through Excel. So let me end with why I think this program is so absolutely necessary. My two classes have virtually no digital experience. We're starting to give it to them, and it's got to be built in much earlier, as you said. And let me end with one last thing. Do I have 10 more? Well, I'm going to take them anyway, okay? I grew up in a real small town in New Jersey many years ago, and we didn't have a Y, and we didn't have a Boys and Girls Club. They were out there somewhere. We had something called the Orange Valley Settlement House. Have any of you ever heard of settlement houses? They were likewise, except they were in areas where a lot of immigrants had settled, okay? We had only one facility. It was a gym. And you went in and you played basketball, or you boxed, or you fought occasionally, or you had concerts, or you had all kinds of things in that one room. And if I learned anything, it was competition, because you had to compete in order to excel there. And now, those institutions like the Boys and Girls Club have programs that are going to help people grow. We're part of it, and I'm really happy to be here. Thank you.
Thank you. Now we're going to hear from Professor Broadman, and she's going to tell us about her her project in the community with the Long Beach Foundation.
All right. Thank you so much for having me. So I'm going to try to keep on time as best I can. Okay. All right, so my presentation is going to be pretty much going through the WIN program. We worked with a community partner, and I'll talk a little bit more about that. The roadmap is I'll talk about the overview, a little bit of the reason rationale, and then everything's breakdown. I know that I've got 5 minutes. I'll try to be timely. So really the overview of this project was to kind of, to give the undergraduate students in my entrepreneurial finance course to gain hands-on experience with a community partner. And so one of the components of the course was adding in 9 hours of digital training. And so the assessments are done for the project, and they actually replace the quizzes and the midterm and final exams for the class. And so not only do they gain that experience, that digital experience, but these are things that they can add to their resume, because I really wanted to have it where engaging in this project will help their marketability when they graduate. One thing that can happen with our juniors and seniors, a lot of our students are transfer students. They come in, they think, okay, I'm going to get acclimated to college. Next thing you know, they're in their senior year at their, you know, the second half of their junior year, and they don't have any internship experience. They don't have any hands-on experience. So I really wanted to have something that was integrated into the course for them to gain that experience. So as it says here, the project helps them build their entrepreneurial skills, helps them prepare for the job market, and possibly create their own businesses. They have the options to work in different topics. So I actually have them broken down into subgroups, and those go over marketing, graphic design, community outreach, social media management, sponsor outreach, fundraising, planning, and event logistics. And really the outcomes and the deliverables of this project is for them to really create a portfolio of their work, which they can use in the job market. Some of the skills that they learn from this is team building, project management, and critical thinking. So I did make some updates to my syllabus when we were working through the WIN program. So as I said before, I replaced their work with this for their quizzes and exams. And I also incorporated a weekly reflection. Really, it's just them saying, hey, I worked with this team lead. I learned these tasks. This is what I gathered from these tasks. And all the objective of this as well is, and these are things that they can talk about in their interview, right? They can say, I worked on this project. I learned these things. So when they're talking about their experience in an interview, this is something that they can share. It really helps helps signal that they're a good job market candidate. Some of the activities I've also include is that they form their teams, they conduct meetings. I also have them do meeting agendas, and then they also do a background research on industries, which kind of complements what is going on with this community partner project. And so the community partner that I've selected is a Long Beach Neighborhood Foundation. What they do is they do a large-scale run really being involved with the community in the Wrigley neighborhood in Long Beach. They are a nonprofit, and so they sponsor athletic events and programs in Long Beach, and then they also distribute funds and proceeds from the run to different community organizations. In regards to the breakdown of my digital training, what I've included is social media marketing, nonprofit fundraising, event planning, communications, best practices in virtual meetings, because they will be conducting meetings via Zoom. Also for the graphic design, includes Canva Essential training as well as Excel training as well. And so the program goals for the interns, this is an opportunity for them to meet with board members and team leads. They're involved in the planning process of the annual event. And they get to really be part of these big picture discussions and strategic meetings that we have for the nonprofit. And so this kind of gives them more of an inner, get a more of a picture of what's going on in the inner workings of the organization. And so these are just kind of the breakdowns of the different topics that they can work on. So like I talked before, like marketing, graphic design, community outreach, and I'm actually leading the group for community outreach. Sponsor outreach, volunteers, planning, and social media management. And all of these skills they're actually able to use, say if they want to start a business or if they want to create a project within an organization, because it's all about team building and community building. Some of the guidelines that we include for the instructor support is that they work with students. I try to have a lot of the work that they do within class, just because when it comes to our students, a lot of them are non-traditional. The median age is 25, they have kids, they have families, they have work. So I really try to have it where the majority of the in-person meetings actually are conducted in the last half of our class. And this kind of gives you just a breakdown of what the timeline is. So we did the more formal introduction with LBNF leaders. We had weekly reflections. They'll actually make a draft of their portfolio, which they can share on job market. And then it'll end with a portfolio submission. And one thing that I also wanted to include is for students, this also gives them an opportunity for them to get letters of recommendation. So from the LBNF founders, the president, as well as myself. So these are all things that they can use when they enter into the job market. And this is just showing the breakdown of the grading. and the final rubric. So really the objective of this is for them to gain that hands-on experience, really be involved in the community, and just really help them get prepared for when they enter the job market. This really helps them gain that confidence and show when they go in interviews, like the experience that they've learned in the classroom and outside. Thank you so much.
That was a lot in just a few minutes. We have a keep you up there, and let's see what kind of questions we have for you.
Okay. Any questions? One thing that surprised me is the amount of interest. Like, I thought, okay, maybe I'll get 3-5 students. I actually have 20. So, and my class is like 30, 38 or something like that. So I was really shocked on the amount. I think what really helped is one thing that I even started with in the beginning of the semester is I asked them, why are you in school? What is your goal? What is your objective? And a lot of them say, I want to get a good paying job. I want to graduate and be able to provide for my family. I'm the first generation student. And so I really urge them in the very beginning, have a working resume, gain that experience. And so when I started presenting this, they're like, this is a perfect opportunity for me to do this. And I get to do it within the classroom. So then I'm not just getting classroom experience. I'm going to have experience on the field. And then these are things that I can automatically add to my resume. One thing that I also wanted to add is probably the second to last class, I want to even do like kind of like a short resume workshop. So once they've done all this experience, say, hey, add these bullet points onto your resume from things that you've learned. They can already add all the 9 hours of digital training and then the letters of recommendation and references. So these are things that they can automatically add, you know, a year before they graduate. So it really helps with their confidence. Any other questions? Oh, hi.
What were some of the biggest challenges?
I would say, you know, with our board, they work full-time jobs. They also have very busy schedules, so kind of keeping them on track, like, hey, you need to, you know, send reminders out to your students. And so I've come in as like a second point person, so when they send communication to our students, they always CC me on it, and that way I can always be there for follow-up as well.
I wanted to see if you could share a little bit about your experience in working with the community-based organization. Like, what was that like, the relationship, developing, things like that?
Oh, sure. So, full disclosure, I live in Wrigley. That's how I found out about Long Beach Neighborhood Foundation, because the run goes, like, right near my house. And the thing that I really loved about I still love about the organization is it's really about building the community, not just the neighborhood, but also other community organizations. They're very highly collaborative. And so we have like Riverfront Coalition and all these other different types of nonprofits that actually partner and collaborate with the organization. And one thing that I really love about it too is it really promotes wellness at a very young age. So I don't know if I can scroll back. This is one of my favorite photos. If you can see, they're starting at like toddler, right? So it's already kind of getting families together, because I mean, I have a 2-year-old, and having time to exercise and think about wellness and self-care is difficult. And you can start runs with your toddler and get a running stroller, and it's just very inclusive, and it really just starts at a young age. So they have they call this stroller strides, and then they also have the tadpole trot here, which is like, you know, slightly older children, like 5 and above. So I just really love the inclusivity part. It's not like, you know, you have to be a marathon runner or be really into like running in 5. Because actually, I'm not out of the board. I think there's like maybe 2 or 3 of us that are not avid runners. But I like doing 5Ks and 10Ks, and I just really love what the organization does. So it just seemed like a no-brainer partnering. Any other questions? Thank you so much.
I have one more question for you. Sorry.
Oh, sure.
So now that you've done this in this class, what does that make you think about for your other classes?
So my other class, it's more of like a foundation level class. I don't know if it would completely fit with this, but I would probably promote the project in case any students wanted to do it and offer it as an extra credit. But I will be incorporating this in my entrepreneurial finance class in spring. And I know that we do have the paid internships as well. So I want to include that and offer that to the students that complete this. Yeah. Thank you so much.
We have one more presentation standing between you and lunch. Hopefully the grumbling is not too loud.
All right, how you guys doing? Been sitting for a while, huh? So this is the tough spot that I'm in right now. You just heard from probably one of the smartest professors in the room, okay? And after me is what? Is lunch. So I'm the sandwich here that's holding you back from lunch, so I'm gonna keep it short. I am so excited about being able to talk because one, my community partner is in the room and you'll meet her in just a second. Before that, I want to make two quick announcements. One is, Sonia, I'm a little bit miffed on your slides because I came from an age that was not on your slide. That was payphones, rotary dial, you know what I'm talking about, right? And I went to CSUN, paid $25 at that time. Yeah, I know. Yeah, that was 100 years ago, but yeah, it wasn't even called CSUN at that time. And secondly, Alan, I know what to get you for Christmas. I've got a box full of ties that will go beautifully with you. Don't ever stop wearing them. So, okay, I'm going to chat a little bit. And what am I doing here to move here on the mouse? There we go. Okay. It's not like I don't get a chance to use this stuff. This is technology, right, that we're using here? Yeah, so... you talk about digital divide. I mean, listen, the stuff that we've gone through over the last 50, 70 years, if you ever look at that list of stuff, it's absolutely amazing. So my partner is Goodwill, and I am so blessed to be working with Goodwill. I've known Goodwill for a number of years in a variety of capacities. And my question to you is right off the bat, what does Goodwill do? Anybody want to volunteer an answer? What is their business? Yeah. Anybody? smartest professor in the room? Yes. Workforce development. Okay, that's correct. Most people think, and my students did when they started working on this project, that they were in the retail business, selling clothes. That is their revenue generator. That is phenomenal. They take and recycle stuff that would normally go into trash barrels, onto trucks, and be thrown away and cause problems, and it gets recycled and sold, and that revenue generates an interesting amount of goodwill. So basically their philosophy is the old philosophy, if you teach a man to fish rather than feeding them, you're going to do it. So it's not a charity. They're actually teaching people real skills and how to be proficient. Does anybody know who wrote who this the artist is for this picture? That's a Rockwell. That's a very rare Rockwell. That's a lithograph. And he gave that to Goodwill. Because Goodwill, if you don't know it, has been around over 100 plus years and started as just a community project, and they've been celebrating the power of work. So that's what we're gonna talk about real briefly here for a few minutes, is the things that Goodwill does. So here are some of the training programs that they do around the world. They've got 100 and almost 200 locations. They're all run independently. All they run different type of training programs. We're gonna focus on one today very briefly. And but these are some of the areas that Goodwill does Goodwill around the world in their training. So we are a partner, along with other partners here, of Goodwill, which is called SoCal. SOLAC. I'm sorry, yeah, SoCal. It's SoCal. Southern Los Angeles County Goodwill, right? 80-some locations, and away we go. And what we're focusing on is a computer skills training. So this is where our digital divide support comes from, okay? I'm gonna show you a brief video with some help from my people on the other side of the digital divide. What do I do? Just click it and it plays? Should be able to click it. And it won't blow up. Okay, here we go.
Wait, one second. Pause it for a moment. It's not using it.
It's not showing?
Yeah.
Yeah, thanks. You always want to have a technical partner, right? Yeah, there you go. So this is Goodwill in Long Beach Training Center.
Talk about it with Microsoft Word. So find your way to the View tab. Remember, the View tab is how we view our document, how it looks to us when we're working in Excel or Word or PowerPoint. So in the View tab in Word, that's where we turn on the Navigator. We can turn on and off the ruler.
Hi, I'm Debbie Wong. I am the digital skills instructor here at Goodwill Solac here in Long Beach. I am the teacher of our beginner and mid-skilled computer skills classes. Our beginner classes and our mid-skilled classes cover Microsoft Office, Excel, Word, PowerPoint, Outlook, and our classes are 10 weeks long. They roll out every quarter. And our classes right now are currently running on Mondays and Wednesdays for beginners. I have two classes, an 8 o'clock that goes till 10 every Monday, Wednesday, a 10:30 that goes to 12:30 every Monday, Wednesday. Those are for my beginner students who are newer to computers and new to Microsoft Office. The mid-skill class that will cover those same topics but go much deeper are in the evening, Tuesday, Thursdays, 5 to 7. Come on in and see the classroom.
So you see how it says add Heather right there? So it's very similar. Go ahead and click where it says add Heather. There you go, right there. Oh, you have Lawrence. You want back up? So when you click on add Heather.
I'm Debbie Wong, the instructor. I wanted to let you know how to sign up for the class. You can reach out to me. You can go to my email, dwong@goodwillsolac.org. And when you reach out to me, I will send you a registration packet. Once I get the packet back, that ensures your place in the classroom. Our classes do fill up. I'm actually already taking registrations for our July class, and it's only May. So when you hear about this, sign up. Classes roll out every quarter, January, April, July, and October. The classes run for 10 weeks. Did I mention they're free? Free to the community. You don't have to be a Goodwill employee. You don't even have to live in Long Beach. I've had students drive in from Riverside, believe it or not. And the classes are going to work at your pace. If you're a beginner and you've never used a mouse, I'm going to get you comfortable on the mouse. I'm going to get you comfortable on the keyboard, get you comfortable in Microsoft Office. Because almost every company out there, every job you get now is going to require you to know possibly Microsoft Word or Excel, and if you have email, you're going to have to know Outlook. We're going to teach you all those things in our beginner class, and once you feel more comfortable, then you can take mid-skilled and get even more comfortable. Would love to have you come be a part of it. Just reach out to me, get you a registration packet, and you're in.
All right, so that's what we're doing. Can you get me set up here? I'm gonna let Debbie Wong, who is here with us today, please stand up. This is my partner in crime, Debbie. I've divided my class. I teach a business, small business management. And I always try and raise the discomfort level with my students. Asking them to do things that they go, oh my God, I've never done that before. And then you usually love it at the end of the semester. They go, God, I'm glad you did that. So this half of my class is working with Debbie, and maybe you can share a few thoughts. And who made this video?
This video was created by social media interns from Cal State Dominguez Hills that I had during the summer. So one of your students. I had six interns this summer. Two were social media, one did community resources, and three were working with me in my classroom with my students, which was so invaluable. And actually, one has gone on and actually works with us now at Goodwill and as a career advisor. So this computer skills program was created as a result of COVID and the digital divide, and also for seniors who were isolated because they didn't know how to get on a computer, they didn't know how to communicate, and they were alone. So my average population in my class, really the big part of the curve is 50s and 60-year-olds, but I've had as young as 20 and as old as 82 in my classes. The partnership with Cal State Dominguez Hills, having the students in the classroom has been really helpful. But meeting Michael's students this semester has been great. They all came in for a tour, and I will tell you, every one of them's jaw dropped when they walked around and saw that Goodwill was not just a thrift store. And when they saw the programs we have, our Goodwill, which is in Long Beach, Goodwill Solac, LA County's so big, there's two corporate Goodwills. So we're south of Rosecrans. And then there's another that covers the top part. So when the students came in, they learned that we had the free computer skills program, which has only been around for about a year and a half. And then we also have a security guard training program. In 2 weeks, they get a security guard, a 40-hour guard card, and we help them get work and follow them for 5 years. We have a certified nursing assistant program. We have 100% pass rate on that certification. Again, they get hired out. We get interviews for them. 5 years, we follow them. We just opened a career center that's available free to the community Monday through Friday, 9 to 4. So we have all these programs, and the students here had no idea. Students here thrift all the time. And now they understand that 89 cents on the dollar that they spend when they go to Goodwill pays for my salary, the computers in my computer lab, the instructor that teaches the security guard classes, and gives us the tools to give those skills to help people who have barriers to employment. We are all about workforce development, but the community doesn't know it. Michael says this all the time, as we do we. We are the best kept secret, and we don't want to be that anymore. Your students have been enlightened because of this partnership, but not only that, they're helping us get social media, they're helping us do other things and getting the word out. They're telling their friends. And so the partnership has been such a great thing for us for that reason as well.
And we want to continue that. Yes. Thank you, Debbie. All right. So just to wrap it up, here's where we're headed. So when I met Debbie, I said, what do you need? How can we help? And these are some of the things that we discussed. And these are the challenges that my students are facing right now. How to get marketing done, how to do a lot of the programs she's trying to get done, how to become not the well-kept secret that they are. And every week, my students meet. There's five teams. They're all working on different aspects of helping Goodwill. And they do status reports, and we send those over to Debbie. They're in touch with her as to what's working, what's not, where we can go. And I'm hoping by the end of the semester that we will have minimum viable products in place to help Debbie grow and help Goodwill grow and do the job that they want to do. This is my classroom. It's an active learning classroom. Students sit in pods and work together as teams primarily. So, and most of the work that they do is experiential in the community. So, all right, thank you very much. Go, lunch.
any questions?
Oh, I got some of my students over here too, by the way. So. Yeah, go ahead. Hey,
Jane. It's such a surprise to hear about that. I don't want to emphasize the competition, but are there other kinds of nonprofits that seem like thrift stores? Like, I know there's a Savers near me. Do they do that too? I guess my mind was a little blown by that. Like, it makes.
Yeah. Savers is actually a for profit.
Oh.
They donate a portion of their profits, but I'm not aware of other thrift stores that are doing workforce development.
Yeah.
That's Goodwill. That's our signature. We've been doing that, as Mike said, for 100 years. So there are other thrift stores out there that donate their profits to other things and have good results from it. But as for workforce development specifically, that is Goodwill.
Awesome work. Thank you.
I maybe just add, like, I work with an agency that does on a much smaller scale, like downtown Women's Center.
Yeah, thank you.
Stores, yeah, where they do, oh, sorry. I was just going to say that, like, I know some smaller scale
organizations that do workforce development like that, like Downtown Women's Center in downtown LA on Skid Row, trains homeless and formerly homeless women to reenter the workforce through thrift store. They actually have like two or three social enterprises that do it, but not on a larger scale like Goodwill.
Good deal. Anybody else?
Are there other topics Goodwill plans to expand their teaching course to that they want to cover as part of the workforce?
Yeah, so just a little bit about me. I have a degree in computer science and math from UC Irvine, and so I've been working in that field as a programmer for many years, took time off, got to be a mom, came back into the workforce, and I wanted to teach. I wanted to pass on my knowledge. That's why I'm doing what I'm doing. We would like to start those certification programs you were talking about today. Our next plan is to, I'm currently developing a Microsoft Office Excel certification, the MOS certification. That will be cost money and will help fund our program. We also plan to do cybersecurity, CompTIA. We're looking to do that, and that's the next step. We are currently interviewing, if you know anybody who wants to be an instructor at Goodwill, to bring in a second instructor so that I can go on and develop those programs, get them started, find the funding for them. But yes, we want to start offering certifications, and we want to expand to a place where not really a competition with those other companies that are charging a lot of money to get those certifications, but to be able to provide it at a low cost and get those people who want to get the certification but can't afford it and get that and become known as, hey, let's go to Goodwill to get our certificate in cybersecurity. That is our goal and our long-term plan. So when I was hearing about that, I'm like, yes, we want to do that too. And so we want to get that going. And yes, that's where we plan to go. Any other ideas on places and things we should grow into, share them with me, because we're developing and growing it. Like I said, we've been around a year, started in May of 2022, and we had one class, and now I have four classes running, two mid-skilled, two beginning.
I'm going to pipe in that you just got promoted to manager. I just found out. So
yes.
Congratulations. All right, I know you're between lunch, so thank you.
We will go ahead and grab some lunch now. We are delighted to offer you a working lunch. So you'll notice on your table that there is a some notes in the plexiglass. Hopefully the presentation from this morning got your wheels turning, and we wanted to, you know, of course, have a lovely conversation on your own. If you're able to answer any of these questions or are interested in some of the, adding on to Sonia's some of the data around the area, would love to invite you to talk with each other about that. And we'll go ahead and have this the first row go first, and then the second, and then the third, and we hope that you enjoy a great lunch. I'll be back in a few minutes after you're done eating, and we're going to share with you. I know we had announced that we got a $5.3 million grant that had afforded the community of practice distribution of laptops. About 2,500 laptops we're going to be distributing, and the student internship. I'll give you a little more detail about that after you have a chance to have some lunch. And then we are looking forward to really rolling up our sleeves and having some workshops. So hopefully you can stay with us to now you get to do the work this afternoon, and we'll continue the conversation. So thank you.